So today we will be covering this digital transformation. This is the successful case study of having the entire SUSE portfolio to our largest European energy client. And this is a kind of a very successful deployment where we are also expanding. So, and there are a lot of learnings in this. While we will cover the essentials of business, how it was aligned towards their digital transformation. So basically, what we are doing is the utilities customer currently are having a tremendous pressure in terms of having their profitability and having the end user also kind of balance between how they give that best experience as well as have the cost into control. So important thing, and their competitors also having a stiff competition in this area. So the three things which business would require in this currently, every business in general, but ENU, energy and utilities business require one, how the IT solution can make them competitive. So basically it's their business being competitive along with their competitors, right? So one is how they can come out with the business challenges in terms of digital channels more and more, the mobile applications and entire thing, the experience what they create from the omnichannel. And the last one is on the data side, how can they give insights to their utilizations, et cetera, to the end user real time, okay, as real as possible. So one is that. The second one is on the IT side, how they can become more productive from the business perspective and in terms of the cost optimization drive what they have. And the last one is in terms of the visibility, self-service, what they want to do. So how can they become autonomous in terms of their business decisions and having those initiatives, digital initiatives, what might they have? They try out early and fail fast, right? Very important in that segment, energy and utility. So what we have sort of done that is very clearly outline our solution towards their business outcomes. So one is how we introduce the technology, like the software-defined technology powered by SUSE. I mean, these are the future thing, which will make customer more and more agile in a way. So the first tangent is how do you introduce innovation to customer, and these are all KRAs of customer. If you fulfill them, they will be happy actually, because every customer is having this innovation as a KRA. So how do you basically deliver the efficiencies, having innovation quotient in that? So what we did is kind of aligned our solution towards this customer's IT. This is an IT solution towards this business goal. One is we brought an infrastructure as a service with SUSE Cloud initially incubated in a small footprint and now expanding to most of the solutions what we are introducing, including PaaS layer, their CaaS, PaaS, as well as the normal workloads. So one is an IaaS, and we are also delivering the traditional VMware thing through this IaaS layer. The second is introduction of the SDS, the Ceph Storage, for S3 interface as well as onto the unified storage. This is working out really well, and we are also delivering the database as a service. Now all of this are kind of a modernizing the current infrastructure, moving them from legacy to the new age infrastructure, just to make it more efficient. So this is the first tangent of the business outcome what we're delivering. The second one, very important, as I said earlier, on the business end user enhancement. So what we are using here is sort of a middleware services and the PaaS layer which we have introduced. So here it's a Pivotal Cloud Foundry. Customer already had Pivotal Cloud Foundry. Incidentally, SUSE having this very, very strong integration and orchestration of capability of Pivotal Cloud Foundry on their portfolio. So it marries it really, really well. So customer had this Pivotal Cloud Foundry initially started in the AWS, and with this compliances and a lot of other new of their own customers, there was a regulatory compliance requirement to get it back on premise and make it hybrid more of and have those new projects for their own end customers incubated on premise rather than on the public cloud Cloud Foundry. So this is on having those enhancing the user experience. Apart from that, they are also having the projects of smart metering and smart, so all those mobile-led analytics insights. So that's what is delivering the end user experience, and we are aligned towards the entire lifecycle. So right from the CI/CD of their DevOps lifecycle, which is completely integrated with the platform, and delivering those outcomes. The third one is on the hybrid cloud, multi-cloud management. So we are using the HCM, if you are aware of, which was a Micro Focus erstwhile portfolio, the hybrid cloud manager, which is basically seamlessly doing those management of public cloud and on-premises thing. And we are also delivering some conversion from VMware to SUSE, et cetera, on the hybrid cloud management. The most important part of our solution lies into the CaaS platform and the PaaS, what we are integrating with, which allows customer to do rapid releases. Now, initially, setting the pipeline, setting those things were kind of more challenging the first time. It's all the first time challenge, but the CaaS platform, what we have today, running on OpenStack instance of SUSE Cloud, is now fully scalable and then integrated in our App Anywhere module. So we will describe, Vasant will, my colleague, he will, gets into detailing of what all we are doing. But App Anywhere from Wipro is basically specializing into the point of view that the application can be run anywhere. And you have the infrastructure and a data fabric which will make them really mobile, location agnostic. So we have created a data service, data fabric, which will actually make the persistent workload, stateful applications move around. So you can make use, and please drop by our booth, Wipro booth, where we are doing the live demo. I mean, it's a recorded demo, but it's a very detailed demo of what I'm talking all about, multi-cloud App Anywhere. So we have any of those cloud, whether it's Azure, AWS, or GCP, as long as it's Kubernetes, you can actually make the application, stateful application, move around. And that's a major blocking element today. So this is one thing. And then the final one is in terms of delivering those smart operations by means of the automation, the lifecycle automation, implementation automation, and so on and so forth. So we are covering the entire spectrum of this solution to deliver the outcomes for customer. And this is a marquee case study what we have to replicate across, right? So basically, the IT solution what we'll be talking about is completely aligned to the business, and we are ready to deliver those strategies what customers has and do that faster and in the fail fast model. So, yeah, sure.
What was the motivation for this customer to have a multi-cloud situation?
So I'll take the question. So initially, customer was already a Pivotal Cloud Foundry customer. So they had gone ahead and done their development on Pivotal Cloud Foundry on AWS. So initial testing and their getting their hands dirty in terms of how to start working on a PaaS sort of a platform and things like that. For their test and dev environments, they were doing it on Pivotal Cloud Foundry on AWS. But the control in terms of how many developers are accessing the virtual instances, what is getting provided, what is getting consumed, for that matter, on Pivotal Cloud Foundry on a public cloud environment, They wanted to bring it under a governance framework. And also Pivotal Cloud Foundry in AWS, it is theoretically it's infinite in terms of getting the resources, consuming the resources. So they didn't get the actual feel of, actually, you know, if I have to develop applications and bring it into, you know, sort of a constructive environment and make multiple repetitive applications out of this. So how do we go about doing it? And also since they had to do a lot of you know, test and dev environment activities, and there were third parties involved where, you know, the smart metering, what Mayur talked about. So they were doing smart metering sort of activities for charging points for your smart cars and for various other things, including some supermarkets and things like that. So for those, they had some sort of NDA and other things which was, you know, which necessitated the workloads to be present on-prem. But since they were already on a AWS, they didn't want to let go the public cloud environment. They wanted to retain the public cloud for some sort of workloads. And for the critical testing, which is under NDA and which requires those GDPR regulations, which Mayur again touched upon, so those were to be put on the private cloud. So in all, they wanted an environment which was seamless for an SI like Wipro to manage across public cloud, as well as retain that same management in private cloud as well.
Yeah, and John, apart from that, there are factors like, you know, Azure or Sales themselves. In terms of those Microsoft estate, to be relevant, they get more license benefit to adopt Azure as well. And right. that forces customer at times to have multi-cloud. So basically, some of those workloads now, with the compulsion of moving into 2016 from 2008 to 2016, because of the end of life thing, and the license benefit what they gave, right? So it's another cloud what they introduce in the customer, right? So
yeah, so like I touched upon, the requirement was for us to you know, develop and deliver a cloud native environment for them to develop applications. And also one of the other key ask from customer was they had a huge virtual machine landscape on VMware. They were having test dev environments, DMZ environments, and multiple other things. To ensure that these environments, which are monolithic, of course, most of which are running on Linux as a operating system, how can you decompose them and, you know, turn it into microservices and ensure the flavor of microservices and containers? Of course, when they did the Pivotal Cloud Foundry, the containers didn't come into picture. So it was LXI containers or something like that was there in Pivotal. But of course, microservices did form a major you know, change factor for them to adopt Pivotal Cloud Foundry. So the agility what they were getting in AWS, the developers got used to, say, firing a command and getting things done in AWS. And the key ask from us was to retain the end user experience, not necessarily modify the methodology in which they are accessing the development environment. If they're using some Eclipse sort of an IDE to start doing the coding and, you know, check in and check out the code, they will continue to do the same thing. Just, you know, abstraction on top of the infrastructure as a service layer and deliver the services to them in a seamless manner. So that was one of the key asks for us. So how do we go about, you know, replicating a public cloud sort of an environment on-prem? And they had given us a strict sort of a requirement that the REST APIs and the triggers what they were doing on AWS, they needed to retain those and probably some amount of minor modifications and ensure that we are able to repeat the and reuse their existing code base and automation, whatever they have created for AWS, onto the on-premise environment as well. So we retained the backend PCF same. So we took a backup of the PCF environment in AWS, set it up on first on a test on a VMware environment. But again, while setting it up on a VMware environment, a managed virtual environment will not do for a Pivotal Cloud Foundry. Pivotal Cloud Foundry requires an IaaS. So when it requires an IaaS, you need an automated compute, automated network, and automated storage, capability to automate all these functionalities to enable a cloud foundry-like environment. So So what we did is, instead of going the VMware route and, you know, layering multiple other, you know, like vRealize, vCloud Foundation and things like that, and also on the network layer, we had to go about putting NSX. The cost parameters and the cost, you know, additions were becoming layered too much for the customer, especially for a proof of concept or to test it out. So the other alternative was to look at OpenStack as a option to put it on the on-prem. But what, which flavor of OpenStack? You know, there's Red Hat OpenStack, there's Canonical, and there's SUSE, there's so many. But what, you know, tilted the thing in favor of SUSE OpenStack was, Mayur talked about HCM, Hybrid Cloud Manager. Erstwhile, it was HPCSA, which they had already taken as an orchestrator for, you know, managing by self-service layer and things like that. That was already in place. And the selling point what we took to customer was, you already have HPCSA in place, and you are in due process of migrating it to HCM, or the latest version of HPCSA, which eventually became HCM. So what we did was, we told since it is from the integration between, say, SUSE OpenStack and SUSE Cloud and HPCSA is rather seamless, why don't we test it out in a sandbox environment or a test environment, and then progress further based on how, you know, we can go about. So that's what we did here. We had to set up an infrastructure or an IaaS on-prem for the PaaS environment. We did that. Then we started, you know, triggering native functionalities of PCF on infrastructure as a service on OpenStack. That did work. Then the next phase of activity which we did was take the existing automation script or the Terraform scripts which were already there for AWS, try and modify it to a certain extent, not to a large extent, to a bit of modification to ensure it works with the OpenStack as well. But one key activity which we had to do was, since the storage side of things, it was S3 protocol was you know, being accessed in AWS, we need to recreate that environment in on-prem. So then again, SUSE came to the rescue. We had to put in SUSE Ceph Storage, SUSE Storage, Enterprise Storage, we put as a backend object storage for this environment for the S3 related activities. So the S3 triggers and the S3 access protocols were seamlessly integrated with SUSE Storage, and that again brought about this abstraction which customer asked from us, and it was shown to them in a sandbox environment. It eventually went into a pre-prod, and then now it's running on a production environment. And again, hybrid. Some of the activities they do it on AWS, but most of their development is now being carried out on SUSE OpenStack.
So, you know, the fundamental architecture we introduced there, and it's a very comprehensive, scalable architecture, what we say, and this is tried and tested for our software-defined everything architecture, what we give to our customers, the large customers. So basically, the thing was they had already VMware virtualization. How do we ensure that they have a investment protection and we scale to what they have? And we added SUSE Cloud on top of that, having Ceph as he said, storage. And then the data management layer was kind of access. So we have kind of a modification to bring the same level of data policies, management, archiving, et cetera, to both of those extended data centers. So they have extended data centers and they have remote sites as well from customer perspective. And how do we ensure that each and every self-service blueprint will have the compliances and security elements brought as part of the post-provision in the standardization, right? So that's one thing which we had used. They also have, as we discussed previous to you come, so they are having a smart metering and their IoT devices in the field. They also has, Vasant mentioned, as a part of their offering, the charging station for smart cars and a lot of other such initiatives needs the you know, the channel to have communication to the central core data center. So this is the first leg where we do the foundation, which is a SUSE Cloud as a foundation. For their remote and public cloud, the same policies. So there we use our you know, our infrastructure as a code methodology for doing all the post-provisioning elements, whether you are in AWS or here, as you said, right, the Terraform, the same script works here on-prem with a little modification, but then those are the blueprint method what we use. And it cut across the thing. And most importantly, what we have done is kind of, as I said, investment onto the layer where the self-service has been created and integrated with various ecosystem element of our customer side in terms of updating those, CMDB updating those, DNS, so a lot of other the things which are required as part of the provision has been introduced at the control layer, which becomes a unified orchestrator as well. And this eventually integrated with the PaaS layer, et cetera, delivers the software-defined application services, which is basically the northbound, all these northbound services are available to integrate with those, either your CI/CD or your blueprint on those application services, right? And we delivered the marketplace from that, from the end user role-based access, and they can do their self-service based on the quota, et cetera, from either from the public cloud or from the on-premises, and deliver IaaS, the PaaS, and the CaaS, which we have embarked already as a phase two, which Vasant will cover in detail. We have created the pipelines from our infrastructure perspective and then made them completely automated. So in all, delivering the end user experience from the access, the self-service, the control, and the power, right? What we have specializes in is our managed services, the bimodal managed services, what we call, which is nothing but how do we ensure that we give the seamless experience of managing the new age stuff as well, what we introduce, right? So that's what, by means of those zero touch operations, zero touch deployments, as well as in terms of those dashboards and SLAs, what we carry out on this architecture. So basically, if you see this architecture overall, delivers the simplified and sustained IT, what we call, has a promise of scalability, future proofing, as well as onboarding all those cloud native applications which they want to add here, right? So we were able to seamlessly add CaaS, you know, on this architecture, simple, because the foundation was very clear. So SUSE Cloud Foundation made it's seamless in terms of introducing the CaaS layer as well, right? So what we will do now, if you have any questions here on this architecture, we can clarify. Otherwise, you know, we'll get into the detailing of the solution of what we did in terms of achieving that actually.
And one more point to add here is that these entire blocks are modular in nature. So like we are also already touched upon, the hybrid cloud manager was already implemented in the customer's environment. So we ensured that which product or which particular you know, application suite will best fit the existing investments of customer, repurposing the existing investment, and also to get the best bang for the buck. So that's what was the main intention for us. And whenever we go ahead and implement solutions or we do the consultancy for our customers, we ensure that the repeatability is there so that customer knows that we have worked as hard for him as he expects us to do. So that's what we have gone ahead and done here. And keeping everything as software defined, you know, it actually unburdens the customer from, say, tagging along to with a proprietary provider, and the entire hardware is a commodity. So it can be from any OEM. We can procure the underlying compute, the underlying storage, but the control plane, like Mayur mentioned, since we are leveraging SUSE's portfolio of products, that helps us to seamlessly extend or scale out as and when required. And again, if we have to, you know, move along to say an additional data center or move along somewhere else on the public cloud, the same usability factor or the same level of automation which customer is used to, be it on an on-prem environment or a hosted environment, we can extend it to multiple other public clouds as well.
Are you going to touch more on that software-defined application services in the detail?
Yes, okay. We will be doing that. Yeah.
So, yeah.
So like I talked about, so initially when the customer's pivotal cloud foundry, they had already made that investment. So that is where, so people may ask, you know, why you're not talked about, say, SUSE's cloud application platform. why didn't you go about putting CAP here? So one of the reasons was CAP was not there during that time. In the early 2016 and 2017, it was staccato. But since customer had made the investment in Pivotal Cloud Foundry, we had to find the best way to bring that Pivotal Cloud Foundry in an IaaS model in the most cost-effective manner. So that is how we had brought about infrastructure as a service from OpenStack, brought about the SUSE storage as the storage, software-defined storage, and we went about implementing the PCF on-premise. Once that was done, we had to go about operationalizing the same, managing the environment, scaling out the environment, and monitoring it as well. So these are the various activities which we are currently performing. One was the environment setup, which we have already done, one on a sandbox and on a pre-prod, and the production environment. The application onboarding layer. The application onboarding layer was taken care of by the Pivotal Cloud Foundry. And the availability assurance is again on the, we are making the environment highly available since the underlying OpenStack is highly available spread across two data centers. The operations and optimizations, since we had brought about so much of automation, in this particular scenario, the automations were carried out by using Salt and heat scripts from OpenStack, and a repeatability factor in terms of if customer wants to enhance the portfolio of applications and to build a new availability zone of OpenStack to onboard a new business unit for catering to Pivotal Cloud Foundry. So we have done that as well. So all in all, as an operations, we are carrying out three major activities: the application operations, the platform operations, and the infrastructure operations. So the application operations are totally on the Pivotal side of things. Platform operations, it's a bit of a gray area. It covers both the infra, the infrastructure as a code, as well as the availability of the runtimes for the application, that the main application for Pivotal Cloud Foundry. The foundation, as Mayur touched upon, the infrastructure as a service on-prem, the maintenance of the SUSE Open Cloud, SUSE Cloud, and also on the SUSE storage, how do we go about managing this? How do we do the operations? So that I'll be touching upon the third item here in a bit more detail. So this entire backend is SUSE, SUSE OpenStack, SUSE storage, and we are using Salt for automating the activities, and the blueprints are being created by Heat template, again from OpenStack. So the activities here are infrastructure setup. Infrastructure setup I talked about earlier. So this infrastructure setup is catering mainly towards Pivotal Cloud Foundry. The activities mentioned here are aligned towards Pivotal Cloud Foundry, be it the environment blueprint creation, environment provisioning, master node preparation. These are all terminology within Pivotal Cloud Foundry. So we have ensured that the activities which customer side engineers and our engineers were doing it on AWS, the activities are seamless, activities performed by an AWS engineer for Pivotal Cloud Foundry. He can still carry out the same set of activities on an OpenStack environment. Then again, on application onboarding, so we had to maintain a runtime repository, an image repository, an artifact repository for catering to Pivotal Cloud Foundry. And then ensuring that the external services, Pivotal consumes external services like MySQL and the other databases. So the external services made available as a DBaaS again from OpenStack. So those activities were also put in place. Then a monitoring configuration. So apart from all this, we are using SUSE's monitoring infrastructure to monitor the OpenStack here as well. So all in all is a good reference case for SUSE, where we have taken all the elements of SUSE and built about a solution, and customer is happy that we are at least he's not telling that put a hold on to your developments, let us see how the incubation period is through and then we can take a call. He is actually hungry for bringing in more innovation based on the activities which we have carried out till date. Above that, the availability I had also talked about, the high availability environment. Customer's data center is spread across two different locations. So we have ensured the availability zones of OpenStack is spread across two physically available data centers. And that particular high availability is passed on to Pivotal Cloud Foundry as well. So high availability, clustering, and scaling, that availability assurance of OpenStack is imparted back to Pivotal Cloud Foundry. On all this, we do day-to-day management from L1 to L3. We do the log management, we do the health management, we do predictive analytics of the underlying infrastructure, whether you know we need additional compute, we need additional storage, those sort of predictive monitoring, and also the PaaS, the top PaaS which is there, the Pivotal Cloud Foundry. We use multiple utilities, open source utilities to monitor the PaaS, and also it is integrated. You would have seen in previous slide, we have integrated with ITSM, we have integrated with HCM. So the ticketing related integration for say Pivotal Cloud Foundry or the OpenStack, any alerts and logs which needs to be captured are being captured in the operational activities as well.
So what we did, so this was, if you have anybody have any questions, after operationalizing this, we had other phases as well. So as you said, we had DevOps setting up, we had application setting up, those end user. We have not covered that because there is a little play of SUSE. The other components were more prominent there. But here at least, you know, it's all SUSE play in terms of integrating, in terms of automating, utilizing those components what we had used. What we have also done after that, a customer has given a go ahead for adding the phase two of that. And that's where we introduced the App Anywhere concept of ours in terms of integrating SUSE CaaS platform and then up here, you know, having our point of view of managing that on that platform. And that is available live. If we have time, you know, we can play it here as well.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So what we are doing, so from the container in general, now outside this opportunity, Wipro in general, we are putting a lot of emphasis in terms of doing the container ecosystem integration as well as management capability, acceleration. So these are the areas, and especially we are focusing on few of this, right? And that is what we are showing in our demo. So one, we are completely focusing on the problem currently what the Kubernetes cluster or any other platform has is the data mobility of a container ecosystem. So if you have a persistent, a stateful application in a cluster, in a CaaS platform, for instance, if it has to move around, there is a problem. So basically, how do you track it, the persistent volume, and then in a stateless environment, it's working absolutely fine so far. So we are solving that problem. And of course, implementation is one thing, but giving the SLAs and managed services is important. So that's one area which we are focusing very clearly. The second area which we are focusing on is the security. Third is on the chaos engineering. So we are doing a lot of innovation in areas of proactive writing those chaos engineering thing, which will be introducing the chaos in the production and test the things. And the last one, we are putting our energies into rack scale design as part of our Compose IT initiative. So SUSE CaaS platform is certified for Intel rack scale design, if anybody was aware of that. So we are also putting our energies into certifying and expanding SUSE CaaS platform on the rack scale design. So this is all what we do. And the finally, if you see, the service mesh is now available, Istio. So we are also introduce Istio in our ecosystem from the managed services perspective. So delivering those microservices in a manner where it can talk to VMs, all of erstwhile traditional applications, also on the container native, cloud native applications, right? So that's what we are adding. So this app, this ecosystem way of doing, we are putting on top of the CaaS platform, which gives the value-added services as well, right? So with that, so what we did in the second CaaS platform scope, Vasant would cover.
Yeah. Mayur touched upon this, based on the success of the Pivotal Cloud Foundry, which we brought on-premise. So customers, the other set of teams were eager to consume Docker containers. They wanted to ensure that their development starts using you know, the 12-factor methodology for container application development? And how do you start out? You know, you can't allow them to again start using AWS, which they already did, and they could not control the prolific spread of AWS and the billing metering chargeback of that environment. So since SUSE OpenStack was already a viable option, SUSE Cloud was already a viable option, how do you, they asked us, you know, why don't you help us using a similar sort of a platform? How do you, why don't you help us by setting up a Docker environment? They didn't talk about a CaaS platform, they wanted a Docker environment. So then again, here again, we did our consulting. We told them, yes, we can set this up, but it need not necessarily be a new environment for setting up underlying infrastructure. That is where the multi-tenancy comes into picture. So we brought in that multi-tenancy, the VLAN segregations and other things into picture. Then also we have brought in physical segregation for the PaaS platform and the CaaS platform. So in this, what we have done is, we've gone ahead and proposed, it's already done, it is a few testing is underway. It will eventually go into production in the coming months. The activities which we have carried out thus far are these. We've gone ahead and integrated SUSE CaaS platform into the OpenStack environment, meaning the SUSE CaaS pipelines has been onboarded onto OpenStack, and that CaaS platform is running on a different availability zone within the customer site. So once that is done, for the persistent storage, which Mayur has talked about, the stateful data, so we are again leveraging SUSE Enterprise Ceph Storage for persistent storage capability. The other option was they were using Active Directory and ADFS from Microsoft. How do we integrate it with that to ensure that they're having SSO and other capabilities? So we have done that as well, integrating with ADFS, then local Active Directory, so that has been done. Then services and routes for container communication. They wanted a methodology or a manner in which the container communications are seamless, effective, and it can be accounted for. So that was the other things which they asked about. They had played around on Docker, they had played on Docker Hub, and they were looking at, say, Docker data center. But since they were already an existing SUSE Cloud customer, it was the only logical step to take them to the SUSE CaaS platform. And this is what we have done. We did a demo, and we have gone ahead and implemented the same.
So when you say you introduced multi-tenancy,
yeah,
was that something you literally had to build on top of CaaS? Or just?
So it's a nice segue into that. You asked for multi-tenancy, and I brought it here.
That's why I paid the big one.
So like we talked about, so the multi-tenancy, how we brought about was, since the environment of OpenStack was spread across two data centers, DC1 and DC2, so the Pivotal Cloud Foundry was already there in the data center. All we did was we had to invest in additional compute nodes to horizontally scale the OpenStack environment, create another availability zone, and create the network segregation for the SUSE CaaS platform. So we have done that in the second DC, and the high availability of the OpenStack, we are retaining the same high availability. The controller spread across two data centers, and the logical OpenStack admin known in one of the virtual machines in the data center. So this
tenants,
is, yeah.
Tenants in this context refer to data center.
Yeah, so okay. The tenants are the PCF tenants and the CaaS tenants. So the CaaS platform and Pivotal Cloud Foundry are logically and physically isolated, though they are integrated through a common OpenStack IaaS. So this is the App Anywhere architecture. So what we have done is, since again, our App Anywhere architecture is highly modular, highly scalable, so we have superimposed the SUSE CaaS platform as the architecture of reference for this customer. So the underlying IaaS is SUSE Cloud. We would be leveraging SUSE Micro OS as the container operating system, and the runtime and packaging, again, leveraging CaaS platform. The automation for this will be provided by Salt and Cloud Init from OpenStack. And the other reason for bringing in CaaS platform from SUSE is the registry, the governance which SUSE CaaS platform brings about, and the Docker registry when you check in and check out your code. That is of more, it is a more rigid and like compliance is of a primary importance to customer. So the Docker registry security was one of the major reasons why, you know, we also pushed SUSE CaaS platform immediately into the customer environment. If again, it was a wild west when you put the Docker registry on the cloud, and the Docker Hub, anybody can, you know, either clone something or use something. There was no control over the prolific spread of the zombie applications, as you can call, which can, you know, go ahead in the AWS. So we had to put a fence around it and ensure that whatever development activities are done, it is done in a controlled environment, in a sandbox environment. And of course, though it is you know, theoretically infinite, but it is limited by the underlying infrastructure which we are going to provide.
So another benefit, what you get from the private registry as against those public registry, is the lifecycle management also becomes easier, right? So when you introduce new things, first of all, it comply towards the security requirement. So you scan those regularly on your workflows. Secondly, you're not dependent on provider to give your security. So basically, what in this case, then everything uses the single registry repository, and through that it can, no matter where the instances are, the registry is common. So your signed registry, and then lifecycle management happens on that. So that makes life more simpler in terms of you know, assured security when you introduce that. It has some cost associated, but then it makes sense. So many customers only talk about saying that we want to have Docker, but it's an ecosystem. Like I said in the previous slide, so many elements there to run the things, you know, like registry is one of them. So it's important that the platform like SUSE CaaS platform or any other, they bring all the services together, and it's tried and tested for enterprise you know, class customers. So it makes sense for us, our life easier in terms of managing them.
Go to the next slide. So the containerization approach, again, this is a typical way of how a customer or any other you know, Docker environment is being set up, and Docker containers are being consumed. So I had already talked about how we had gone ahead and first, in the first step, we had gone ahead and done a OpenStack availability zone extension, created, onboarded the CaaS appliance on top of it. And once that is done, we did a sandbox testing and then extended it to a pre-prod and then a prod environment. So the other flows are typical to your CI/CD in terms of how you take a Docker file, create a Docker image, then check it into a Docker registry. You build the application, then you may ship it, store it in a Docker registry, then run the application. The process of the run the application is where we are bringing in OpenStack. So OpenStack ensures that it triggers the SUSE CaaS platform, instantiates the containers or SUSE micro OS to run the application. So the bundled applications which are you know, checked out from the Docker registry are run on the SUSE CaaS platform, which is powered by SUSE OpenStack. So once the applications have been tested, in case these applications need to be scaled out within the limitations of the availability zones under which the application is being run, the scaling of the application is also possible. The same scaling of application will again be leveraged using the previous App Anywhere framework which Mayur talked about. The scaling of applications, once it can be either scaled into another private cloud, or it can be scaled into public cloud as well. Again, bringing about that governance, which we had talked about from SUSE registry perspective and from the OpenStack perspective. So these are the various steps, typical steps for containerizing an application or running a containerized application. So all we did here was to ensure we enhance the flavor of SUSE in the customer's portfolio. And right now the SUSE footprint is high, and we hope to increase the footprint further and also try and replicate the customer success in multiple other places. So this is our way of doing it. And we were one of the earlier adopters of SUSE CaaS platform. So it is working well. So if any of your customers would like to look at CaaS platform or a bit hesitant in terms of whether it works or not works, it works in a European setting. It works under the GDPR scheme of things. It ensures those compliance and regulations are being met, and it makes our lives easier because, again, SUSE executives are there to rely on, and the SUSE support is there to rely on, and we are able to scale out applications on demand using these frameworks. So this helps us a lot, and we would, you know, any questions from your end, we would be glad to answer them. Claudio, any questions you've got?
So what we have done, just to make it real, so we have our innovation center in Bangalore, where we have done a massive investment in terms of the heterogeneous environment there. We have a dual data center invested in our innovation center, that's a COE. It's two campuses connected by a dark fiber. So we have a capability of simulating a real customer use cases there. And we do the entire, so before we had onboarded here, we have the entire SUSE thing tested thoroughly in our engineering center, innovation center. And that's available to customer. So basically, one customer gets a head start for adopting something. And what Vasant told, that we were successfully been able to incubate those technologies in that customer. One of the reason is we have already done that in a sandbox. We have shown that to customer as part of our demonstration. So that's one, how we bring in the efficiencies to customer and reduce the time to market. The second one is, you know, we have really made an effort to make customer also talk about the outcomes, how it is aligning, and customer really, you know, enjoys some of those things when you help them to take those brownie points to their management and get out of those messaging which aligns to their business, right? So one is how are we enhance their competitiveness with our solution is one very critical thing which we have brought out. And the last one is in terms of the engineering. So we do a continuous engineering. So like I said the slide on that container ecosystem, we do invest on those proactively. And hence, customer can leverage on those engineering aspects little early from our side, some of those in the pilot stage. We also do customer premise pilot, as Vasant said in the sandbox, right? So basically, they can leverage, and hence, we can align to the client's roadmap effectively. So these are the value proposition what we bring in from Wipro side, apart from, you know, leveraging the good innovation from our partners. Right. So these are the complementary investment what we do to ensure the success, the joint success from the client perspective as well as the SUSE solution what we have. Right. So that's all about what we wanted to cover today on a high level case study walkthrough.
I've got a couple of questions.
Sure. Okay.
I'm not sure if I missed it. So what is the application transformation roadmap from the customer going from the containerized apps to the cloud foundry? Is there any?
The roadmaps, as of now, like I said, natively on Pivotal Cloud Foundry, there are no native Docker containers. We'll have to go about PKS or something else for orchestration and then putting Docker into their environment. The adoption, because of some, they are dictated, like Mayu said, it is how their customers, you know, push them for applications. So they are already using Docker in, say, Azure or Google Cloud, or for that matter in AWS. So that has necessitated customer to adopt containers. So how to adopt containers, and, you know, they're already having the flavor of PaaS. So how to extend the flavor of PaaS into a container ecosystem, how to ensure that, you know, you can compose an environment and you can destroy a container, spin up a container, then put in a backend persistent storage if required, or it is a stateless application, and, you know, if it's an ephemeral storage, if it is there for a testing environment, you put an ephemeral storage. And then again, if that needs to be moved into a production and that has to have a persistent storage, how do you bring in that persistent storage? So what we did was, especially on the persistence, the data stickiness and the persistence, right? So where we had earlier shown this by bringing in the S3 protocol onto on-prem, triggering it onto a native SUSE storage. So that actually helped us to sell the story of persistent storage. and the Docker container and a Docker storage. Any which way, any Docker, if you want to again attach a storage, it's again spinning up a Docker container, and again that will be spun up on the Ceph. So that is where we wanted to complement customers' requirement. They had a flavor of, say, a Docker container, but how do you put a governance layer around it, and how can we tell them that let your developers start using containers, but Wipro is here to support you and monitor that environment and operationalize the same. And once we are able to operationalize, then customer is happy to move it into production. If you are not able to support during operations, then the journey from, say, a sandbox or a pre-prod into a continuous production, it becomes a bit of a problem. But that is where we are helping our customers as well. And we are always, agile in our environment as well, where we are continuously innovating in our COE. We are training our engineers on the latest and greatest technology. And thanks to SUSE for, giving us earlier access to CaaS platform and things like that. And like Mayur said, we are also getting some early access to technology from other providers, other hardware vendors, and the other storage vendors and things like that. So that enables us to bring it to customer once the general availability of any product is made, announced in the market, we are there and ready to, cater to the customer needs. So that is where our way of thinking, and you talked about software defined everything. So we are also agile in terms of getting people geared up to meet the challenges.
There was one time you talked about scanning to ensure things were proper before the release. Is that part of the CI/CD within this? Or?
There are scanners available which can natively integrate with Kubernetes. So when you as a part of your workflow, when you access the image, and if you do any changes there, let's say you have a patch, you have an updated registry image. It goes through the scanning, the complete scanning. If there is a problem, it gives you a deviation, and then you decide. So that also can be automated. So it's the salt driven customized automation. What you do and define what you do to the deviated ones. So once you allow that officially, that's okay. This is supposed to be done. It gets into that image. Again, the next time scan will be done on the compiled version, the approved version, right? So that's what the scanning of registry from the infra perspective we do, and it's a regular scan.
So we also do this infrastructure quality assurance regularly as part of our solution offerings. We also do the infrastructure quality assurance, not only from infrastructure per se, so that extends to our CI/CD and our DevOps toolchain as well. So again, integrating tools like, say, SonarQube or something else to validate a code, whether it is, it adheres to certain principles. And also some of our other customers also have, guidelines to check a particular image against CIS benchmarks, whether it is, it is scaling up or it is meeting that requirements of CIS benchmarks. So once that is there, especially on the images and the glance images on our OpenStack and the container images, which is there in our Docker registry, so we ensure that it meets those challenges. We bring in maybe third-party scanners like Qualys or whatever. But again, it varies. Since it is modular in nature, if customer needs that, I have already made an investment in a third-party application for doing this testing or validation of my code base. So as long as it has a REST API and it allows us to, do this northbound, southbound integration, we do these integrations with the customer's existing tool base. And put it as part of our overall App Anywhere scheme of things.
So please drop by to the demonstration. I think we can explain there more practically. Because it's.
We are Mumbai Pro.
You didn't introduce yourself. For anybody who doesn't know you.
Yeah.
So I drive Mayur Shah. I am based in Bangalore, India, and I drive the global data center practice, what we call, and I drive also as part of my initiative, Software Defined Everything initiative, where we are supposed to incubate this great technologies to customers by whatever means, right? By means of pilot, POC, ensuring that they get the confidence, having our capability showcased by visits, making them visit our center. So that's what I do.
Yeah. So I'm the principal consultant for Software Defined Everything and part of Mayu's team based out of Frankfurt. So I cater to continental Europe customers. So since I regularly need to be available at a customer environment, it makes sense for me to be there. And of course, yes, it actually helps me navigate customer requirements much faster and much easier. So any of your customers who are, you know, require any of our services, be it Mayur or myself, we are available. We are here to, you know, help you out.
And he has been instrumental hands-on as well in this customer, actually, while not only selling, but also being part of the delivery cycle to ensure things are.
So that's what happens. Any new technology which we need to take it to customer, we need to actually run it through thorough tests and be there to guide the customer and give them the confidence. It's only because of that that the customer is able to now adopt new technologies, because of the confidence he exhibited earlier in, say, OpenStack and things like that. So that plays well in us, you know, extending this to other customers as well. This is a very good reference case. So unfortunately, we are not able to name the customer. Once we are able to get that go-ahead, we will probably in the next few months be able to put as a referenceable case study in our website as well.
Yeah, and mind, these are painful also. I mean, it's not that works so seamless. There's a lot of learnings, actually. It's 3-4 years of learning, I would say. Setting up the OpenStack has been,
yes,
painful as well, while it sounds very easy. But yeah, so we have a good learning. We have those learnings now applicable. So the next deployments are easier than what we had in past. But yeah, it's improving and it's good. Now it's very, very stable.
So is there a website or something anywhere for like a roadmap of
app
anywhere?
So we will be trying to make it available publicly, but at this point in time, it is internal. It's
internally.
Our internal framework. So this internal framework meets customer requirements. So this is for us to ensure that we have got a hold on things. And this is an internal framework. And if, of course, any sort of slideware on publicly available, once it gets cleared, it will be made available on our wipro.com website.
OK, that's it. If you have any other question, we're happy to.
Please drop by our booth. We'll be able to answer your questions.
And show whatever we told in action.
Thank you.
Thank you.